Okay, great. So please stop me by if something goes wrong with the slides here or if I'm too fast. So myself, Dr. Ashwini, today I take this leverage of presenting to you the strategies global-wide for the COVID-19 vaccine, and especially COVAXIN OOV. I would like to go through a little preclinical and clinical stuff as well, what we have at hand, and also an ongoing studies with respect to COVAXIN. So as a little backgrounder, so as you all know, the structural components, I wouldn't go too deep into this because I have already taken up some time. So the crowns for the spikes happen to be the queen of the eye. So we all are looking into that, but development of COVAXIN happened to be the whole virion. So this is all inactivated and packed up as a vaccine. Just to know the structural components, I will just skip the first introduction slides here, just the pathophysiology, which we are all aware of, the ACE and the way the mechanisms are innate and adaptive immune system in action when there is an external pathogen, virus or bacteria to eliminate from the system, how the cytokines come in action and thing, and the clinical symptoms associated with SARS-CoV-2, especially COVID-19 happens to be the most common, the severe and the complications associated. The timeline for the viral load to clean up from the system, and also the antibody response to the particular virus of action is little depicted here, and it's been published.
Ashwini, your slides are not moving.
Oh,
yeah. Okay. Can you click on the slide and then see if it moves?
Yeah, it's moving up from here. Which can slide are we starting?
Full screen?
Yes. Can you see it now?
No. Ah, yeah, it is moving now. Anyway, go ahead then. It is
okay,
moving.
The first part was the sexual components. Second was the pathophysiology and an innate immune system activation and how the symptoms happen to evolve. And a timeline of the viral load clearance and the antibody response in action. It's just an intro of how things are taken up by the virus itself and how it gets in hold of the host immune system. And multi-organ complication as such, looking at the spike or the M or the nucleocapsid wouldn't be enough. So as a whole virion inactivated virus, COVAXIN has happened to eliminate most of the multi-organ complications associated with COVID and the long-term COVID associated symptoms. So which we are going to see as we go through our phases of trials we have been to take care for the last couple of months. This is how the evolution of, can you see my slides now? Are they like rolling around or are they stuck? Is it okay?
Moving, but can you make it full screen there?
Yeah, the full screen ka problem. Something wrong with the full screen here again. If I start, they might stop. Let me know if this doesn't roll around.
Okay.
Yeah, the SARS-CoV-2 evolution and the genetic kind of mutations which it goes through, which from the D164G, which we happen to get the prototype from Wuhan 1, happened to be our prototype for this virus. And from there on, the evolution of this particular alpha, beta, gamma, delta and delta plus. So we are aware of the genetic mutations ourselves, but all three variants, the efficacy has been will be discussed in our presentation today. So as we say, so many types of vaccines around, and why an inactivated whole virion would stand out from all particular vaccines is a point of understanding. So we will be discussing mostly for inactivated, the whole inactivated viruses, which is a COVAXIN. So among the marketed drugs and we will be looking around mostly COVAXIN today. A little less on the variants for comparison from COVAXIN and COVISHIELD. As per se, they are different, which is looking solely into the spike protein, and whereas for us, it is a whole virion. As Sputnik as such, an adenoviral vector itself. So let us get started with the COVAXIN history and a little life cycle of it and what's going on in the current studies and upcoming studies. Can you see my screen now? Are the slides moving? Am I audible?
Ma'am, the slides are not moved actually.
The slides okay. are
yeah,
not
madam, moving. You are audible.
Now it is moving.
Yeah, perhaps I have to put it in this way because the whole screen, maybe the full screen is stuck for some reason. Okay. So okay. Can you adjust with this screen? I'm really sorry.
Okay.
So we happened to go through the evolution, then we came out to the different types of source code to vaccines available and three marketed drugs which are currently used in India. So we'll be mostly discussing about these variants of choice and of concern through Covaxin and Covishield's perspective. And mostly Covaxin development would be our strategy today. So let us start with the Covaxin overview. This is a product profile we have at hand. It's indicated for active immunization against SARS-CoV-2 infection. Active ingredients happen to be whole virion inactivated SARS-CoV-2. We have achieved the strain from National Institute of Virology, and that's the strain. And the dosage forms are liquid 0.5 ml, and antigen concentration happen to be 6 microgram. It's an allergen. It's an aluminum hydroxide with a agonist for TLR7 and 8. We call it IMDG, and dosage administration and regimen happens to be day 0 and 28. Target population are over 18, and safety profile so far for the last three trials we have at hand, we have an excellent safety profile based on these studies. Presentation is both single and multi-dose vials, and the storage happened to be 2 to 8, and shelf life approximately 2 years. So, this is how the vaccine was actually developed. The initial baby steps happened to be strain isolation from ICMRNIV containing this particular mutation, and it was isolated from COVID-19 patient from Wuhan and sequenced at the ICMRNIV. It was provided to Bharat Biotech and was licensed. So manufacturing process at Bharat Biotech was initiated. It was constructed and got accreditation, and a biosafety level 3 manufacturing facilities which were already well established. And the VeroCell manufacturing platform is our in-house kind of platform, which has been used for rabies, rota, and other Genvac vaccines, which are at hand with the portfolio vaccines at Bharat Biotech, with the proven safety in other licensed live and activated, as I said, Genvac, rota, and rabies. This helped us for the rapid development of the candidate drug, which we call BBB-152 here on, because it was not named Covaxin since beginning. So the preclinical studies, as we say, was conducted in mice, rats, and rabbits, followed by an appropriate safety profile. Both in humoral and cell-mediated responses were captured, where we found the efficacy of BB-152 was assessed in severe hamsters as well and non-human primates, the rhesus macaques, and found to be protective against the live viral challenge test. So the clinical studies in humans showed both phase 1, 2, 3 appropriate safety, immunogenicity, and efficacy profiles, which will be detailed in the next slides. So as we say, this is just an overview on how the strain was characterized, how the VeroCell banks have been established, how the virus was cultured, how the inactivation purification formulation methods were in place, and how the final IND approval and the vaccine came into market. So it's a preclinical and clinical studies which we happen to take care here. The developmental, the animal studies were conducted and published across, as you see here. Clinical trials phase 1 to 3, the number of subjects as well, accordingly. So I'll just give you an overview, quick overview of the preclinical studies here. The immunogenicity and safety evaluation, what we found, have a robust kind of safety, toxicity, reactogenicity. Detailed toxicity profile was done in this particular species, bulb C, NWZ, rabbits, and Bister rats. So we found paramount Th1 response, high neutralizing antibodies, especially S1RBD and N-specific antibody titers, and hematology was stable enough, and other histological path effective and safe. So two live viral challenge tests were conducted, one in the rhesus macaques and one in the Syrian hamster, both provided us at paramount safety. So here is a little understanding of these two challenge tests. After challenge, the nasal wash, throat swab, especially the upper airway clearance along with the lower airway protection was observed with both 6 micrograms and 3 micrograms. So whereas the 6 micrograms of allergy IMDG, as I said, the TLR7 and 8 agonist is now will be called as IMDG, which proved us to be more effective all along in clearing the viral load. So that will be the purple line, the third line. So this is how the upper and lower airway protection was observed. So we went ahead with 6 microgram Algil IMDG from here on. So neutralizing, as I said, just a pre-conclusion of this, we found neutralizing binding cell mediated responses detected in all animal bodies. Models, TH-biased responses, one biased responses were observed mostly in mice, and especially in non-human primates and hamsters post-challenge had lower viral load, and this reported better viral clearance post-challenge. Lung tissue samples from these non-human primates reported no evidence of eosinophilic infiltration, which is a good sign of no cell migration or to the adjacent tissue. Other DART studies are underway. We are doing this for upcoming pregnancy in HIV patients, so that would be of not concern. So reporting to date, we have primary outcome phases, especially phase 1, 2, and 3. One happened to be the safety across 375 subjects in between 18 to 55 years. And phase 2 among 380, and phase 3 is a larger cohort around 25,800. And we found this particular efficacy against severe COVID happened to be 93, asymptomatic happened to be 64, excellent lot-to-lot immunological comparability, and overall 77-point efficacy has been noted and been published now in Lancet. So vaccine efficacy to a particular variant of interest, of concern, which would be Delta variant, is 65.2. I'll go through in detail for the slides of this slide in the coming one. This is an understanding of phase 1 trial. I wouldn't go in detail of everything, how they are enrolled. But the study endpoints happen to be safety. And we found there is no immediate AESO reported and immunogenicity profile comparable. So this is from the phase 1. We found that vaccine-induced neutralizing antibodies were equal to a panel of human convalescent serum collected from COVID-19 infected volunteers. So we also found that VV150 induced interferon gamma, CD3, CD4 and CD8 T cells, which also gave us a quick understanding of the TH2 responses other than the TH1. Algil IMDG T cell activity was more pronounced than the standalone alum formation. So, and the next one, post-vaccination for a long term, the vaccine-induced neutralizing antibodies persisted for at least 3 months. That's what we see for 3, 6, and Algil alone. Again, for the 3 month post-vaccination, Algil IMDG T cell activity was more pronounced than the standalone alum formulation as previous slides. So these are our flow sorted ones to show that we have a clearance here more for our Algil IMDG than the name. So BB152, this would be our second phase 2, and which is published in Lancet again. Here, this is an overview of how it is being conducted. Arms, it's a 2-arm study. We found that vaccine-induced neutralizing antibodies were equal to a panel of human convalescents here, again collected from the infected patients, as you see, mostly from the 6 micrograms of Algil IMDG at day 56. So seroconversion was 98.4. This is SARS-CoV neutralizing anti-response after day 56, as you see, that's the highest peak we could reach. When it comes to the TH1 mediated response, we could see that TH1 cells were higher in ratios or the quantities than to that of the humoral responses. Vaccine-induced cell mediated response were biased more towards TH1. Virtually, we couldn't find most of the TH2 cytokines expressed, which is a good sign. So this is a pre and post vaccination slide. So solicited adverse events, since a phase 2 comes with a little load of reactogenicity. So the profile of Covaxin has been significantly lower than vaccines based on other manufacturing brands. So that is a good sign for us to go to another level of the study, which went ahead as a phase 3 study, efficacy study. So across 25 sites in India, 25,800 subjects were enrolled, and our CRO partner happened to be IQVIA. The major objective happened to be to evaluate the efficacy of this versus the placebo to prevent symptomatic COVID-19. The secondary was to evaluate the vaccine of choice, especially lot 2, to prevent severe COVID-19. These are our objectives. Secondaries happened to be the immunogenicity. I'll just go through the consort here, and 26,000 happened to be screened approximately. Enrolled were 25,798 to be precise. Across 2 arms, both Covaxin and the placebo arm, at day 84, we had so many numbers, around 11,909 for our Covaxin. And day 84 happened to be the 11,895. Nearly the dropouts were very minimal. So participant disposition, we found no baseline kind of difference in the characteristics. So the demographics were stable across. And no difference in the baseline, as we say, the anti-IgG sera, especially the positive prior to allocation, happened to be very minimal. So PCR positivity prior to allocation, which 0.8 were included for some reason. These COVID-19 positives were removed from actual efficacy analysis, but were safe, were followed for safety. So the first occurrence of virally confirmed RT-PCR positive symptomatic case of COVID-19 per protocol. This is how they are being cumulatively looked at the probability of first occurrence. Okay, that was for placebo. This was for the Covaxin. You can see that, you can just see the difference in themselves. So the first COVID-19 occurrence from the 14 days after the dose 2. This is how we evaluate our efficacy, most of the efficacy trials. So as we see, the BB-152, Covaxin and the placebo. Efficacy rates happened in the first symptomatic COVID-19 occurrence. 14 days after dose 2 happened to be 77.8 with a 65.2 to 86.95 CI. Whereas the first severe COVID-19 occurrence greater than 14 days after second dose, symptomatic was 77.8 and severe COVID-19 happened to be 93.4. So this gives us a protection which is near to that of the other marketed drugs. So occurrence after 14 days after second dose, this is how the vaccination period of 28 days, monthly onset asymptomatic PCR tests were done in around 6,289 per protocol participant. This is a very robust follow-up, which is not done elsewhere in India. So at least for every month, we have an on-site kind of per protocol asymptomatic testing going on and swabs being taken down. So we found that an efficacy of 63.6% for asymptomatic COVID-19, especially post 14 days after second dose was observed. And for symptomatic plus asymptomatic, we found 68.8, which is on par with the other marketed vaccines. So secondary efficacy happened to be equally among, highly equally among the person years. So the, as you see, it is by age, if it is distributed around 79.4, if it's again gender 72.3, and again comorbidities with and without, it happened to be with 66.2, and no comorbidities, it is the highest efficacy of 85.2%. When we come to the swab processing for variants, so active surveillance, as we said, for 15 days being done for 14 days after the second dose. So every 15 days after 14 days of the second dose, we have nasal swab, one for RT-PCR, two swabs were taken. RT-PCR, one for sent for RT-PCR, the central lab, and one was sent for sequencing. So the 79 swab samples we could assess in these days, the genome sequence was done in a central lab, and we found that 60% of the sera, especially sequencing, came out to be positive for Delta, 5% for Alpha, 13% for Kappa, other 17, and genome, which was not retrieved, was happened to be 5%. Now the efficacy, the variant efficacy of Covaxin against these variants happened to be Delta with 65.2 and Kappa has being the highest 90.1. The others could not be assessed. The lot-to-lot consistency when it comes to three lots we have tested for our phase 3 trial and the GMT ratios, especially geometric mean titers of our neutralizing antibody titers happened to be excellently across all three lots stable. So the GMT ratio intervals contained within 0.5 to 2 proving equivalency. That means they are exactly matching to each other. So irrespective of the lots, the vaccine works better. So for a subset of different study groups, we have assessed our S protein, our BD and N protein, and these are particular lots. And we found an equal stable efficacy for all the three lots. When it comes to safety, we have a paramount safety at hand. Proportion to all AEs being between groups was similar. So there are no major adverse events which have been recorded, and incidence of solicited adverse events after each dose by system organ glass also proved us there was no thromboembolic shocks or other kind of complications observed, which were found weak. So the phase 3, we would like, this is a little conclusion from our paper. So safety, solicited adverse events around 0.5% to 8.2. And serious adverse event, this one's vaccine to that of placebo. Was similar between both groups. Efficacy, our vaccine reported an overall efficacy of 78 with severe COVID-19 93, asymptomatic 63.5, CA were above the 50% success rate as studied from other standard trials across the globe. So immunogenicity responses across three consecutive AGMP lots were equivalent, and vaccine efficacy on Delta variant happened to be 65.2%, which is a paramount understanding for the current scenario. So here is a clinical trial overview, phase one, phase two, phase three, and ongoing studies. I would just come in a minute about that. Evaluating a booster at 6 months is what is ongoing along with the nasal study. So before that, I would like to go into a bit of the variants of concern, which would be comparing Covishield to that of Covaxin and other mRNA vaccines. Of course, mRNA vaccines have proven for that, but Covaxin has shown around 77.8% vaccine efficacy among symptomatic participants. That means which show participants who show symptoms. Strong nonlinear relationship between neutralizing antibodies and efficacy predicts 50%, at least 50% of protective neutralizing level across the variants. So that means when you look at 61% for that particular Covishield, Covaxin stands around 77.8. That itself shows where we are with the efficacy point. So across other variants of choice, this is a little summary of our in vivo live virus neutralizing studies conducted from phase two serum. So we found that for B.1.1.7, that is alpha, which was isolated in UK, there was no difference in the neutralizing activity between the alpha and the prototype D614G variant we achieved. So we started with actually. So the variant of concern again for Zeta, around 1.9-fold reduction in the neutralizing antibody titers was found in comparison to our prototype. And for Kappa, 2-fold reduction. And for Beta and Delta, Beta 3-fold and Delta 2.7-fold reduction in the neutralizing titer against our particular prototype. So this shows how good the vaccine would work. And to summarize, Covaxin meets international guidelines. Our non-clinical data supports vaccine effectiveness and safety. Phase 1-2 data supports safety and persistent immunogenic responses. Our vaccine meets all safety data expectations 2 months after second dose for at least 25,800. We studied no severe complications were observed. The safety was paramount. Sufficient case of severe COVID-19 to severe efficacy was observed. Final efficacy with a point estimate of over 50% was established, and neutralization data has been published against alpha, beta, delta against with Covaxin, and Covaxin benefits outweighs risk based on well-designed phase 3 clinical trials, especially consistent manufacturing, lot consistency matters a lot. Robust AEFS system is in place, and post-marketing safety is also underway. So trials in HIV pregnant individuals are being planned now, and these are the publications for so far we could achieve with Covaxin, and these are global presence, especially for the emergency use listings across 94 countries. Approval received from 14, under evaluation for 35. And this is little presentation of vaccine, how it has been stored, the vial policy and stuff. And today, 85 million individuals have been vaccinated, and tolerable reactogenicity profile has been established. So thanks a lot. Have your jab. Any questions?
Thank you so much, ma'am. Now the session is open. If the participants have any questions, they can ask.